positive reviews from both academic and popular sources. UMC Press notes, E. Patrick Johnson challenges stereotypes of the South as backwards or regressive, suggesting that these men draw on the performance of Southernness, politeness, coded speech, and religiosity to legitimate themselves as members of both Southern and Black cultures. Dr. E. Patrick Johnson is chair and professor in the Department of Performance Studies and professor in the Department of African American Studies at Northwestern University. Please join me in welcoming E. Patrick.
My sister centered on being on the school grounds, Mercy Street Elementary School. It's no longer there, but it was one of the colored schools in Madison, Georgia. And us running out to the edge of the schoolyard and asking my mother and asking my father for a nickel. And he'd pull out a handful of change and give my sister a nickel and wouldn't give me one, saying that he didn't have any. And I remember crying and that kind of thing. But I think the most painful memory is that of my father's cousin, Asa. Now, I do not know how that was spelled, but that's what they call a cousin, Asa. And his wife's name was Major, and their last name was Talbot. Cousin Major said to my mother one day, now my mother's name was Annabelle, and everyone called her B. She said, B, why don't you give credit to me since Aunt Amy and W.S. don't want it? Now, since Aunt Amy don't want it, now her name was Eva, but she was simply known by Amy. And my father's name was Washington Spencer Stiles, but he was simply known by his initials W.S. Anyway, she said, why don't you give credit to me since Aunt Amy and W.S. don't want it? He's standing there. And so I started crying and hugging my mother around the legs, and I must have been very young because my mother was only 5'2". And I remember I was just at about her knee. So I was a very small child. And I remember crying and saying, Mom, are you going to give me away? And she said, yeah. And there were other things, but those are the more painful memories of early childhood in Madison, Georgia. Now, I've been in counseling and crying and all of this stuff. I think part of it had to do with the fact that it was commonly known that I did not have the same kind of protection of my grandmother, my father. Because my grandmother was a larger-than-life figure, and I think people respected her. And some minor people feared her because she was a big woman. And she was very outspoken, just a kind of strong personality. I think they knew that it opened season on him because they don't want him. So you can do pretty much what you want to him. Well, what did your parents do for them? My father, in Madison, Georgia, worked for a planer mill, which was a processing mill for lumber. They would cut the lumber into planks, and planks into planks of boards or whatever. But my mother was always in the best of them. In 1952, when we left Madison, Georgia, my mother and my sister and I came to the net. First of all, my mother came. I guess it was probably in March or April of that year, because it was before school was out. She came to take care of her mother, who was ill. And she probably came back late April or early May. And she said to my father, I heard her tell him this on many occasions, that the two of them just could not make a life in Madison, Georgia, because there were simply too many external influences. And she kept warning him that she was going to leave him. So when she came back, this was in 1952, she was going to take us, move to Atlanta, and she wanted him to join us because she had decided the two of them just did not make it in Madison, Georgia because there were simply too many external influences. And so it was about the time of my major. We moved to Atlanta, and my father was supposed to join us. But back then, you're so young, you couldn't remember this. But there used to be a time that if your father could go to the boss man and say, oh, I've got a friend who needs a job. And the boss man would say, well, bring him on. So some of the men in the neighborhood where my grandmother lived had lined up a job for my father. And on the day that he was supposed to come, he didn't come. And I remember seeing him on the front steps, waiting for him much of the day. I knew the direction that he would come from. And I got happy several times thinking that it was him when I saw someone who sort of looked like him. So I remember how disappointed I was that he didn't come. And he never came. Instead, he moved to New Jersey to live back, one of the external influences my mother had in Madison, Georgia. They moved to New Jersey, and they had, I never knew how many, but 10 or 11 children. I had all these half siblings. They were in Jamesburg, and my father lived in Somerset with all these daughters. And so my parents never reunited. And certainly here I am, 60 years old, about the age of years ago. I did. I was in counseling from 1988 to 1995. I mean, I really didn't go to counseling to do individual work. My partner and I were having some problems, so we got into couples together. And sessions with some of the therapists figured out that we each had our own stuff that we needed to deal with. And of course, I was looking at all that he was. And I don't know if it did him much good or not, because I don't know if he knows or not, but counseling is a very scary process. You have to be able to, I think, open those doors. And you have to also be able to, I think, give up on what I call one of the prevalent myths in the Black community, this sainted mother myth. You have to maybe see her for who she is, that just because she's your mother, she's no saint. You can still love her, but you have to kind of see her for who she is, or either parents, or either of your parents for that matter. Because in many instances, both the mother and the father, they can do no wrong, you know? Well, I should say, you know, but I don't know what your situation is. But when I was in school, if you wanted to fight out of somebody, you say no. Now, I don't know if that's true today, but I suspect that it probably is. And everything you can say about someone's mother might be true. But just the fact that you're saying something awful about someone's mother will give you a real fight. If you're going into counseling, you have to be able to see those people for who they are and deal with the experiences that you have. But at some point, I cut off all communication with my mother. For several years, I didn't talk to her. If she called me, I was kind, gracious, but I didn't call her. My counselor said I was very brave when they made that decision. I was in a room of 10 people in counseling, and they were just all kind of amazed that I could do that. But I made this decision after years and years and years. Because the other part of the story is that my father and my grandmother didn't want me, but neither did my mother. Well, she was determined to keep me because her mother didn't keep her. You see, it didn't matter how badly she abused us. Her saving grace was always, at least I would give you away. Because my mother was given away as a woman. The story I've heard is that my grandmother was very young when my mother was born, and her father gave my mother to some other people when my grandmother was at home one day. And so my mother never forgave her mother for giving her away. She was very angry and tormented and very abusive of my sister and I. And her saving grace was always, at least I would give her away. So that's why she was determined to keep us no matter what. But it mattered, she treated us like dirt. So that's the other part of the story. So for much of my life, I felt very much alone because in Madison, Georgia, I thought I had my mother. But once she moved us here, have you seen the movie The Exorcist? I tell people that once she moved us here, her head did a 360 degree turn. And one of her favorite things to say was, if it wasn't for you, my life would have been wonderful. So hearing that as a kid is why I started to have thoughts of suicide. Because just think of it. If you're a little kid and your mother says, if it wasn't for you, my life would have been wonderful, you're going to start to think about not being here. You hate making her life awful, and you start thinking about not being. And for many years I was suicidal, and that was one of the issues that I dealt with in counseling. And I think that those thoughts were kind of planted there by my mother making that statement. Now in high school, even in elementary school, there was one teacher in particular who would sign a girl to tell her if anyone bothered me when she left the room. I later found out that she was in fact. And she was a mad lesbian. She had children and a husband, but she was in fact a lesbian. And so she would sign a girl to tell her. And so I was kind of protected along the way by people. You know, there was always a bigger boy or someone who protected me. You know, now the bigger boys, I never had sex with them. I just had a sense that I needed protected. And something else happened. When I was in sixth grade, some boys were bothering me, and the teacher kept us after school. And I would carry a little single-edged razor blade in my pocket to sharpen my pencils. Because if I went to the pencil sharpener, they would bother me, you know, maybe someone would attack in my seat or do a little something, just a little kid harassment. So after we came down to school, the boys would want to line up to beat me up because they said it was my fault that we kept after school. So I would always say it, the sweetest little voice, because you see how reasonably soft spoken down. I minded my business. Don't bother me. So this boy ran up to get me, and I cut across the shoulder with my razor blade. And by that time, the teacher came back, and she said, "You boys better go home." So the last thing I heard him say was, "You are mean, little sister. I'm going to have your ass locked up." So I went home. I didn't say anything to my mother. And bravely the next day, I went to school. And the same boy came up to me, and he had a hairline cut across his shoulder because I had cut through two or three layers of clothing. He said, "You better be glad." I said, "Liz, do not bother me. I keep telling you to leave me alone. I want to be left alone. I'm not bothering you."
"Don't bother me."
And what always happened, if anybody attacked me, they always ended up seeing some of their own blood. Because I would hit them with a sharp object or bite them, but they would always end up seeing some of their own blood. So because I was so supple, there was no way they could twist my arm or do anything that I could get out of it. I could run, and I could run if I had to. So rumors spread. Don't mess with him. He's a mean little sister. And he's strong.
Very proper, had a flair and a knack for grammar and presentation, and you know, I didn't cut grass to the traditional things that most boys' minds would do. I shopped, you know, I shopped, and that was, you know, my interest.
Michael is a diminutive man that carries himself in a grand fashion. In fact, he describes himself as a favorite grandchild and favorite grandson in his family. He's also very well connected in the black community in Raleigh, North Carolina, and has been president of various black political organizations. The interview took place on October 28, 2004 in Raleigh, North Carolina. Are you out to your family?
Everybody in my family knows, you know, in my immediate family in particular. And then my aunts and uncles know, my grandmothers know. It was not easy for me.
What were their reactions?
Their reactions. For example, when I had his 21st birthday party, my father was the first person to ever say, you know, he pulled me to the side, he gave me money, told me happy birthday or whatever. He said, "Somebody said X. Gay, and I said, "Really?" And he said, "People will say cruel lines," and that was it. And I would have friends, you know, who would call the house or whatever, my brother who was in high school or junior high at that time, and say, "Michael, some fags on the phone for you, you know." And I would say, "Give me that phone, boy." Whatever. And my other sorrows would call, you know, I'd see them at the phone. Before I could get home, my mother would say, "Well, Michael, such and such called and said that you were at the mall hanging out with some gay boys, you know, that you were hanging around these gay boys." And I would just go on and live. But I think the straw that broke the camel's back was when I was modeling for this major boutique type store here and moved from that one to one where my cousin does hair. And I had this high top fade thing. And she asked me to do this hair show. And I said, "Yay." And she said, "You gonna let me perm your hair?" I said, "Girl, do whatever you gonna do as long as you gonna pay me." Well, so she permed it. And after it permed, it failed to hear. And it was this really pretty long bun. And she said, "That's so pretty." And you know, because all this was cut off, but then I had this big float bun. And she curled it. And she curled his bun. And I went home to my parents, and my father was doing the hedges. And you know, I get out and I'm just walking, you know. And I'm going upstairs. You know, I never pay any attention to my father. I really don't. So I'm going up the steps, and my father grabbed me by my mane, tried to cut my hair with the hedge clippers. And I'm just hollering like a little girl, like, "Daddy, Daddy, what are you doing? You messing up my hair." So my mom comes out, she says, "Leave him alone." And it ended, whatever. But you know me, I go right back to the salon to get my hair done. You know, so I never paid any attention to what people said, you know. I just always felt very confident about myself, and the gay issue never bothered me. But you better not say anything to me about it, you know. People have always been afraid to ask me, approach me about whether I'm gay or not. They may think whatever, but they're not going to say anything.
Well, I would think that given the fact that you had a gay uncle, that it would have been a big deal to you.
Well, you know, my parents were very hurt in the fact that I had been engaged twice. You know, they said, "My uncle, you know, your uncle has done this, you know, you're hanging around with him, it's his influence." And they were very upset with me for a very long time. And realistically, my uncle played absolutely no role in this whatsoever. I mean, he didn't even know I was sleeping with me, and he lives in D.C. So he played absolutely no role. So for a long period of time, not for a long period of time, for a few months, they took away my allowance from me. Because they said, "You're not going to D.C. spending my money going to those gay clubs and these gay bars and all this kind of stuff." And I was like, "Fine." My grandmother gave me the money. My uncle gave me the money. So I still deal whatever. But I think one of the greatest things about my parents is that being gay has never changed. I am, you know. And at some point, I don't know when this happened, you know, I was riding somewhere, and my husband was coming over to a meeting or a funeral or something. And this lesbian pulled up beside us. She said, "Look at that damn lesbian," you know. She was just going up, "These damn lesbians, gay." And I said, "Yeah, girl, you know." And at some point, you know, they just forgot, you know. They just see me like they saw my uncle, you know, as just their son, not their gay son. And at times, they really have to catch themselves, you know, because they'll talk about gay people and the gay issues. And they forget. And I took the crutch and I said, "You want to whistle?" And I started swinging it all over and busting people. going to have to scratch that name out this gas will call. You know, she gets on the bus and she's going to speak to me, you know, and the bus driver and I have known each other for a long, long time. So they had to live in my faith and said, okay, we'll write you a guest to pass, a guest to pass the class. Yes, an excuse, pass the class, you know. And she said, you know what, you're getting in fights, you know, about yourself. You know, what you need to do is show them how bright you are, such that instead of giving them a fight, you know, set the curve, and they'll beg you to help them with their homework. It worked. I made them pay. You never tell me about tutoring. I learned to buy economics, you know, my services, my goods. And I have this, you know, this talent, and I have this commodity, and I know how to package it. You need me to pay, call me a name. Piss me off, I'll raise the score. And it wasn't good enough for me to get 100, you know. I had to get the extra points, you know. So I was at the curve at 105. And I would look at them and I'd say, now suffer. Call me Sally now. Oh, please do, you know. Call me Sissy now. Come on, please do. And that's what I mean. You know, call me that, you know. I'm going to take home the A, you know. So folks found out it was better to be my friend and get a C than to call me fat and get an F. Folks used to beg to sit by me during exam time. So they thought they could cheat. I had to deal with this one teacher. I said, I'm going to write all the wrong answers to the problems with it. I'm going to correct the answers until I'm not going to correct the answers until folks were nice, you know. And then in high school, it was the same thing, you know. I can't tell you how many folks I helped through high school, you know. All roads to a diploma led through me, you know. And this is not meant to else, you know. I'm serious. Folks would be like, hang out, man. You know, and now it's like the second generation of them coming and asking me, can I help my boy with his turn pay? But you know, boy, some things never change till they learn. It was so much fun doing that. And then talking, she said, use your brains. She said, it's easy to fight the fight of another way out. And remember that, she said, eventually somebody's gonna throw you out of school and you're so talented, you know, you're so proud, you know. So do this for me, you know. That's what happened. That's how I got my revenge.
Well, were there other people in your
that people saw us there, and how did they treat them? You know, that's interesting, because, you know, the African American community does not hate gay people. We hate gay. We hate people. We think are gay. You know, we don't ostracize gay folks. We never have, you know. And if they're rich enough, we'll make excuses for them. And if they have children, we'll make excuses for them. And the only reason you have this very racist, sexist notion of the download of it, and I'll explain that, is because of HIV. In fact, we admit it. Well, it's not admitted, it's called a closet person. That's been going on since we were back then, you know. But we all told folks, be in the closet. We don't care what you do. Just get married, have some children, adopt if necessary. It sounds like we're talking about Supreme Court of Justice nominee. But we invented that, and I was thinking, I always hear older say, no, why not be honest? Well, what is it is there to be honest? There is no sense of being honest. Zero, you know. And I love to tell this, first of all. And let's go back. It's racist because we assume that only African Americans get on the down low. They're the only ones that are cheating on women with other men. That's racist and stupid, you know. Honestly, can't we judge black men with all these white men who want big black dick? Obviously, that's not the case, you know. They don't want to see you on Sunday or whatever through the week, but on Saturday, you're all the rage. You are it. You are the it girl or the it boy, you know, or whatever. But it's also sexist because we assume that women don't bear to hide their sexual identity. And as far as the HIV, I cannot tell you how many brothers have told women, I can't tell you how many sisters have told brothers, why are you wearing a condom? He must be a punk. Take off the ship. You want to talk about why I can't trust this man? My worldview is assumed that everybody with HIV is positive, and conduct yourselves accordingly. Conduct yourselves accordingly, you know. I mean, nobody's telling you not to use a condom for a reason to act this way. Why should he? Because I would have said, you're going to ostracize this person if he does this or that, so they do exactly what you say. Well, we don't mind you being gay, just don't be a flaming gay. You give them what they want, you know, and you're mad about it. I mean, you're the lie that the lie produced, you know. Don't get mad at the person involved in the lie that you told them to produce. If you don't want a dog, don't win. So if you want the truth, then you start at the beginning, you know. So you have this idea of the download brothers causing AIDS. No. No, no one told you to spread your legs and have my protective sex. Nobody told you to do that. I mean, nobody else. In case of rain, nobody made you do that. Nobody. And sisters, if you take ownership, I would love to speak to you about my hat. I said, why have you told so many brothers you were willing to be responsible? Harry sent your brothers and told them if you don't use a condom, that's proof that you're a punk. And a few of the brothers that I know said, well, I could go somewhere else. Number one, I can't afford a child. Number two, I don't know what you have. And number three, maybe I'll just get some baby horn. And they have said that, you know, where are those comments on broad? You know, where is that? Where is that thing? I don't hear that. And where is the part about, well, I'll make a deal with you. I'll be honest about who I am if you don't fire me next year from that HBCU for not being married in my 30s. You can't have it both ways. You know, and the African-American community is going to have to decide, do we really want to be honest about these issues or not? And right now, we're being academically dishonest, you know, about this issue. And a lot of people are dying, you know. And that's the tragedy, you know. After said silence equals death, what I did, lying equals death in the African-American community. And we have been involved with this vicious, understood lie amongst ourselves. And it's time to start telling the truth. And we've got, and if we're going to hate, quote unquote, faggots, then don't be surprised by settlement evolution that these faggots are going to mimic what you say should be a successful brother. I don't understand why that would not be the case. I really can't understand it. I mean, I would love to ask them, what do you expect? This is what you want, you know, this is what you're saying is acceptable, that the person giving you what you claim you want and they're upset about it, and then you don't take responsibility for your own body, and then you blame the other party. I have a problem. I have a major issue with that. And I'm saying, and again, nobody told you to gap your legs. And I mean, wide open arms to protect yourself. Nobody. Nobody. That's what I mean. And that's what women, cats, and dogs, and rabbits do, you know. And like, as far as I'm concerned, every time I enter a sexual relationship, that is potential Russian roulette if I'm unprotected. Being protected is not 100%, but I know I have 0% if I don't use protection. Sorry. And then I think it's a sin that the black church doesn't have AIDS ministry, since the case of AIDS is so much higher in our community. It's a sin. Everybody wants to talk about Christ and deities and all that, but I happen to have read that book. Yes, that 66 volume book a few times. Yes, I actually read it, you know. It didn't just sit on my desk and collect dust and everybody's birth certificates in it, you know. I actually read it, you know, a few times. And I remember that the deity said, feed my sheep. If you love me, feed my sheep. Take care of my sheep. And then in Matthew 25:40, he said, whatsoever you do to the least of these, you do to me. So that person that's singing in the choir that might have spots, or I have heard spots in 2 or 3 years, and 3 years later, this is still a part of the not a party, but a part of the African American community. And we're going to have to be honest. I mean, we can't even call it AIDS anymore. You know, we call it the ninja. Oh, yeah. They call it the ninja. Or does it only sing? You know, ooh, we sing. And you can tell by the inflection what they're talking about. Ooh, we sing. You know, I'm just waiting for somebody to come up and say, oh, he got R-O-M-A-R-D-S. I just can't wait for them to come out with that, but I mean, that's what we have here, a lot of dishonesty.
Is there any particular theory about homosexuality that you ascribe to?
I call it apple pie peach pie. And I was saying that. I believe that there's orientation. I believe that every person knows their orientation. I believe that in a given world, everybody will gravitate toward it if they like pie, their apple pie is pretty, or peach pie, or both, if that's what one chooses. I believe that in this world, we have been told that the only pie that is acceptable to eat is that peach pie. And I think the people will eat that peach pie to survive, to get a job, to stay in a better relationship, to be in a family, we all to go to certain churches. To move up in social ranking, you'll eat that peach pie. You may be dreaming apple, you may be praying about apple, but you may be lusting apple, but you're eating peach. And if that apple pie goes away, you will eat that peach pie because you need food to survive. You'll eat it. Like it, but you'll eat it. But I've got news for you. If somebody in the room said, there's an apple pie from the bakery over there, you know, it'd be like this Russell Spence song, person didn't do so, either Adam took it over, you will get there, you know. You will take an airplane, you'll use a camera, you will use whatever, but you will get to that apple pie. And I think there's a lot of unhappy folk who've been eating that peach pie, but their orientation says apple. And so there's this week's preference and orientation. You may prefer something else, but you'll eat peach, you know. And if you think that there is a peach pie, believe me, you'll eat it. But if you had your choice without preferring recrimination, and notice how I said that without recrimination, you'll eat that peach pie. But if you didn't have to worry about getting your head dashed in like that poor guy in Morehouse College a few years ago, but yet you don't see the civil rights leaders talking about hate crimes. Interesting. I mean, we have Matthew Shepard, we talked about that, but we didn't hear about that one brother getting hit over the head because he thought he was looking at him in the shower. Ooh, and this is Atlantis. This is supposed to be the Mecca for black gay folks, and you're wondering about my terrible. So my advice to gay brothers and sisters who are going to school, don't go to an HBCU ever. But anyway, I believe that without recrimination, folks will go toward that peach pie. I believe that about issues about transgender. In a perfect world, people will go toward their orientation. If they will go toward their inner gut, some people call it consciousness, some people call it whatever you want to call it. I don't care about the nomenclature. I don't care about the Klingon. I don't care about the language, the lingo, the Klingon, the slang. Whatever it is inside you that tells you that you're you, I think it's a pretty good guide. It'll tell.
I think the church is a lot of hypocrisy. Because who you think is directing the choir? Most distinct in the choir is that Fabian. In most black churches that I am aware of, are black gay men.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think there's so many like gay men in the choir in churches?
This might sound really silly. That robe is very much like a dress. That they can carry on and shop in that sort of dress. I have observed gay men really shouting and carry on in these robes, working the robe. So I don't know, this is my own little silly kind of thought about it. And it's like a performance. They can perform. They can perform and they can sing.
Why do you think there's so many black gay men in the church, especially in the choir?
That's a question I need to ask them. Because I will not tolerate being castigated as the masses in the sermon. I can't be castigated and say, oh, he's a bachelor groom. I cannot do that. I think that there's a very schizophrenic relationship. There's not wink, as if to say, Daddy, you know what I am, but I'm really working on it. And you know what we are really working on, and that is almost a way of atonement. Like, I know that you don't like what I'm doing, but listen to me sing. It's all that Bible. You let me in, and you let me go to our community, and I will grant you this service. And I remember the different cloth. I say, if you don't like my value or what my gifts, you should be granting me that.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond all of my faults and his harmony, and I will forever lift my eyes on Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died.
I'll just go back to that. fourth grade, because that was something that was important on my.
I decided, though, we're not going to hear fag every day. This is so. I remember picking up like a 2x4, went down, and just was like, beat the children. I'm like, you know, we can hear this. So I came home, and the program's there, and I'm not going to do it. I called my father, and I'm sitting there still feisty, like, no, I'm not hearing this no more. I'm not hearing this ever again. And I did, because I was clear this off. I'm not doing this every day. And that's one thing, and you know, by old school, they say you better go and keep that ass. Because you keep that ass, it puts an end to it.
Cece was born in 1961 in Greenville, Mississippi, but now lives in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. There's no other way to describe Cece but as a character. Outspoken and charming, Cece's views and approaches to dealing with racism and homophobia are quite unorthodox and speak to his unapologetic defiance of social norms and values. The interview took place on November 5th, 2004, in Tuscaloosa.
You know, my mother never was interested. Because my father really couldn't stand people of the church. Because he thought they were all ignorant, you know. And he believed in God. He believed in us going. And so random. And I had these incredible conversations about, can you believe that shit they set up in churches, you know? Because he just thought they were ignorant, you know. He'd be like, all these people who were irresponsible. Oh, the Lord's gonna take care of God, you know. He really had issues with that. And to the church on a regular basis. So it's really interesting, you know, because I've been exposed to all kinds of things. You know, I've been Catholic, I've been Methodist, you know, I've been sprinkled, I've been sanctified, you know, I joined it all, baby. Dumped under the water, over the water, walked on the water. So those years were very formative.
Were you active in church?
Yeah. Usher did those things. I was very active. But you know, because the church is like a safe haven for gay people. People still try to deny it, but the church is full of gay people. There's more gay people in the church than they are in the bar. So you know, even as a young child, you know, I don't get to like put two or two together, so it's not like anybody's had any bad experiences up in churches. Even if the preacher was gay back then. Oh! And when I got old enough to understand it, yeah, I had to like let it go. Because you know, I never understood what I call the churches. And what I mean by that is that they're everywhere. You know, in Atlanta, I was full of them. And mind you, I thank God, and yes, I won't say nothing bad about it, but you know, I never could understand that concept of people going up in places where you're going to be bad. How did you find Jesus up in there? So I, on purpose, avoided what I call churches. Like, all the churches, don't stay away from them, because you know, it's just a little bit too crazy for me to slip over all the benches and stuff. You know, and then at the end of the night, you're going to be like in the bed with somebody, and they're like, hey, because you know, I hate yourself. So now I never want none of that hate sex at all, you know. I stay away from church. Well, what is your current religious affiliation or your perspective on religion and church? Is really church without walls? Thank God I found peace with it. You know, you just have to know Jesus for yourself, believe in that. You know, I walk around this house every day and talk to God, you know. All the time, just in
physical sense as opposed to the verbal, I will act out the way that I want to be perceived, or the way that I felt that I was, or the way things were. Like I said, my cousins had dolls, and I liked to play with their dolls, and style their hair, and their clothes, and things like that, and play with them, interact with them. I did not want to play with my brother. I did not want to play with his stupid trucks. I did not want to ride bikes or knowing that bus was a boy's bike. It just did not behoove me to do such.
Jazz was born in 1969 in Catawba County, North Carolina, just a stone's throw from my hometown, Pickering. Surprisingly, I did not know Jazz as a child, partly because he grew up in a neighboring town, and partly because he was living his life as a woman. I first met Jazz when I visited my home church several years ago. He was singing in the tenor section of the mass choir. Chastity introduced herself to me, of all places, at my brother and sister-in-law's annual Christmas party. It turned out that not only was Chastity a welcome guest, but also my sister-in-law's hairstylist. The interview took place on September 7, 2004, at my sister's kitchen. For the longest time, I always knew that there was something different about me. I always knew that when I was this grown, I was quote unquote a male. My mother never hesitated to remind me that she had two sons, that I was very feminine in my energy. And I really had suppressed those feelings because of the way that I was raised in church. You know, you really were not supposed to be sexually active until you were grown and married. That's not to say that I did not have attractions or affections toward me, but because of the way that I was raised, I really was afraid to enact. It wasn't until I enrolled in beauty school and met these two entertainers that were quote unquote drag queens, not female impersonators, but drag queens. What's the difference between a drag queen and a female impersonator? Well, a drag queen is quote unquote a man dressed in a feminine way, but it's more so for the theatrical aspect of the entertainment factor of it. Female impersonator is also a male. Conditions their body, conditions their look to emulate femininity, and it's true as essence, you know, to pay compliment to what it's like to be a feminine or a woman as opposed to being a modern woman. So upon meeting these two gentlemen in the school, they introduced me to gay life. You know, I didn't even know there was such a thing as a gay club, you know. They put me in quote unquote drag. I had a talent show that took me to drag, but the drag just was not enough for me. I felt like there had to be more too. And this particular morning I was watching a talk show, Donahue, and he was interviewing a woman named Carolyn Causey, and her stage name was Tuba. And she was from London, England. And she was one of the world's first transgender people. And she was a supermodel, and a beautiful woman. And so I was so intrigued by the show that I watched a transcription of the plays. And then I was the elevators here in my hometown. I found a sexual there. Upon finding on my schedule appointment, I went to see him. He diagnosed me as a pre-operative transsexual, saying that I had to use female chromosomes in my body and my anatomy to fail that the medication, surgery, given my body was actually supposed to be made of iron rats. But part of the process was that you were to be subjected to living as a female or to live out the gender reassignment for at least a year. The minimum of a year. And during the course of that time, you were to be evaluated mentally, physically, and emotionally to make sure that you were truly transgender. I did that for 5 years. For 5 years, I ate, slept, drank, but it was like to be a female here in England. After the 5th year, in the course of that time, I had been engaged in the lifestyle and a lot of quote-unquote entertainment. I began to friend to tell me, after you have the surgery, girl, you're not going to have time to play for us. Because of the gay community, they saw transgender people as almost totally different lifestyle because you're no longer considered quote unquote a male or a female. You're not crossed over to the straight side. You know, it's like a world totally unique to yourself. And so, because of reason that you decided to remain, not to go through with the surgery?
Coming back then, like I said, the stress with my mother, because my mother would not accept me whatsoever. She and I fought like cats and dogs, literally, physically, and mentally, because of my decision, my indifference. So, I had a bad dream one night. And in the dream, I saw this SUV pull up into my driveway, and out of the SUV stepped my brother. The sooner that he stepped out of the SUV, there were like hundreds of people who surrounded him, and they brutally beat him to death in my driveway. In the dream, I recall running to my mother, to my father, to try to awaken him from his sleep, but they would not awaken him. I went to the doors and to the windows, beating upon them, and it was to no avail. I could not get them open. I recall waking from the dream, and my hand was still on the telephone receiver, evidently where I was trying to dial 911. For help, because my brother was lying in my driveway in a pool of blood, and there was nothing I could do to save him. So the dream shouldn't be up so bad or so intense that I couldn't get back to sleep. I was a nervous wreck to say the least, and I called my god sister, and she told me to come over. And while I was waiting for her to come over, there was a friend of mine at that time was Linda McCormick, and she was one of the only friends that I had that was, quote unquote, very spiritual in the church. She was saved, you know, she was always witness to me when she would come and get her hair done and things like that. But she was not overbearing me. She called me that weekend before and asked if I could do her hair, and I told her that I was too busy. Really, the reason why I wouldn't do her hair is because in the lifestyle that I was living, I had acquired an addiction to marijuana. And the addiction was so much to where I was. My marijuana habit probably ran me $3,500 a week. I ran tabs and supplied. I was really angry that particular weekend because I couldn't find my drug of choice, and it was my party drug, you know, it was what helped me to be me, it was what helped me to say to hell what people thought about me or damn what they said. But I was adamant that I had to have it. Yeah. I went like 3 days without it, and this is the third day of the night that I had the strength. So Linda called me that morning, and I wanted to tell her desperately about the dream. And so I told her, just come on down to the house, and I'll cut and style your hair down here. And so upon telling her the dream, I couldn't even get the dream out without weeping profusely, because it was really, really horrifying. And Linda did nothing but sit there the whole time, very quietly, a lot like you are now, listen to every syllable that I was saying. Then I asked her, did she know what the dream represented or what it meant? And she convinced me that the dream was not my brother in actuality, that it was me. That the people that was there kicking and beating him so profusely in the dream were not people, but actually my enemies. And that it was a matter of time before something very, very horrible or terrible would happen. And that God was asking me to allow him to shield me. I really didn't know how to take everything in that she was saying, because, you know, I was spiritual, but not to the level that she was. She was going to noonday prayer that day because it was Wednesday. I said, well, when you go to pray, will you pray for me and my family? She said that the Lord had directed her to pray, before she left. And in doing so, this overwhelming feeling came over me. I accepted Jesus Christ right there. I went through with that. Linda was my mentor, and I was living life in her eyes. I really didn't know what it was like to be, quote unquote, saved from my sins. I was trying to appease her, trying to appease others, and my family, and my mother. My mom was just happy that I was no longer wearing dresses. She was happy that there were people who were no longer talking about her son, the one who wore dresses, and thought he was a woman. So we were wearing suits. Yes. The night that I had the dream, I was in my bedroom in Victoria's Secret. I didn't even have undergarments, let alone shoes, clothing, nothing. Nothing that pertained to a man that I possessed. I mean, my God, for the past 5 years, I ate, slept, drank, read, what it's like to be a woman. I was flown to Los Angeles, California to be on another talk show called The Other Side, because there was a particular show called Psychic Health. side. And the psychic was Patricia Michelle. And she was, at that time, known as a world-renowned psychic. And one of the questions that I asked her was if I would ever go through the surgery. And after having the surgery, would I truly find happiness? And what happiness to me was, at that time, was a very good age. You know, I was so late to have, quote-unquote, a natural life. You know, my idea was to have the surgery, to go out and marry. Technology did not allow us to have children, to be able to adopt, to join the church, you know, to get in, have a beautiful home, to pick it up, and to put a dog. That was my idea. Needless to say, that is no longer the subject. My ideal life now is just to be content, to be happy within the skin that I'm in, you know, finally learning to embrace everything that makes me who I am. All of my differences, all of my attributes, all of my qualities, as well as my faults, and realize that God has made the mistakes in making me. That His word said, I was fearfully and wonderfully made. Who am I to say anything different? And so now you're at a point where you're fully embracing who you are, but you decided to remain preoperative. Exactly. And what has brought you to that decision more so than anything else was because that once the doctors would have done the reassignment, meaning the physical restructuring of my body, the only thing that they would not have been able to tamper with was my essence. You know, who I am as a person. Yes, Charles would have been no more. But chastity has always been and always will be. Chastity, I do believe, is here before Charles was. And the one thing that the surgery would not have been able to change is that very fact. And why should I put myself in Bruce losing my life on a surgeon's table to appease others? And would it have truly appeased them? Like I said, I had to become comfortable with the skin that I was in and realizing and knowing that a physical change was not going to change who I was mentally. It may soften the blow for me to say, well, shit, at least she looks like a natural woman. You know, she's got a vagina and very soft, smooth skin, a long, flowing hair. But does that truly constitute being a woman? Or does a penis or facial hair and muscular build or physique truly constitute masculinity? The only one that can stop that is yourself. I mean, I had to learn to be content with who God had birthed me to be. He gives us free reign over our lives, over the choices that we make, and how we govern ourselves and act upon our lives. So I can be whoever I choose to be. You know, I can put on the most elaborate ball gowns, the most quaffed furs, every bit of chastity that I dare to be, but it doesn't change the fact of who I am to him, or the type of friend that I can be to others, or the son or the child of the Lord, so that I am to my parents. So are you performing again tonight? I am. I just recently started performing possibly 3 months ago with my mother. Like I said, the only reason why I've gotten away from it is because of me going into the church, trying to live amongst the church's stereotypes of Christians. Should be rather than seeking a personal relationship with the Savior, which is truly what Christianity is all about. And knowing that His greatest commandment is that we love one another. But you can't love someone else until you first learn to love yourself. And being that I've embraced that, yes, it's allowed me to embrace my limited nature. And the character that I like most to impersonate is Pam Gray. And a lot of my friends and family, quote unquote, fans, say, quite a bit. A future goal of mine is to possibly land a job in college, and it would be right a great honor to be able to perform before Patty. And my favorite song of hers to perform is You Are My Friend.
So since you're back entertaining, you still go to church in drag?
No, because they're like two separate lifestyles. Chastity is quote unquote almost like an alter ego. She's very much a part of me, but it's something I choose not to share with her. I have no points of confidence in her. Chastity is, for lack of a better term, like my recreation. She gratifies me as far as my artistic sense. Chastity has charisma, chastity has fun, but chastity does not have a church. Chastity believes in God, she loves the Lord, but that's about the extent of chastity.
But Charles goes to church?
Charles goes to church. Charles loves the Lord as well. Charles is very tolerant. And when I say tolerate, meaning I tolerate anyone's beliefs, whether it's good, bad, right, or wrong, it's simply to acknowledge that you have a belief in something, and I value it. I may not suit or fit me, but I like to I'd like to be able to distinguish and to separate myself from my needs and my beliefs and we all need to say, because what struck me may not work for you. Who am I to judge you for that?
Well, how do you feel about the life choices that you've made in light of being gay?
Hopefully, I've been able to let someone know that being gay is not all bad. That they're just people, too. That being gay is possibly their choice. Maybe it's their birthright. Maybe it's a little joke played on them by their higher power. But they're still people. If you cut them, they will bleed. If you suffocate them, they won't breathe. If you don't feed them, they'll die of starvation. If you allow them to flourish, if you allow them to live, they'll flourish just like you. I pray this book is able to change lives. Every life, every hand that picks it up, let that life be transformed, let that mind be renewed.
Anna, we step on mattresses with most animals.
Chin-chin.
You ain't never seen a chin-chin.
A chin-chin?
Yeah, a chinch.
A chinch.
It's a little one. It's a bug. And it sucks blood. Mm-hmm. There are a million of them, and you just be killing chinch that nobody do.
They just want to have you and kill it all the time. They want to get up there at 88.
They have a million votes to kill.
Countess Vivian. Countess Vivian is the oldest black southerner I interviewed. 93 at the time of the interview. He was unbelievably agile and lucid. I was unable to find Countess Vivian after Hurricane Katrina, but just 3 weeks ago, I had a reunion with him in New Orleans. Not only did he survive Hurricane Katrina, but he never left New Orleans during the storm. The interview took place on January 22nd, 2005, just a week before my arrival. Was there a gay community here in New Orleans in the 20s and 30s?
Oh yeah, I hope today. But at that time, I did not know or realize that they had white sisters. Because all the ones that I ever saw was on the other side of the track. Because the railroad tracks run way up there on Canal Street, the Southern Railroad, right beyond Randolph out there, and the gay bars were all black. Just like they got today. Just like they got lesbians today, they were really black lesbians, all black on that side. Just like I said, I didn't know because we didn't see the white gay people, because everything was segregated, no only gay. The only time you come over here to French Quarter would be if you were working. You couldn't run, or you couldn't do this, or you couldn't do that. You could come over here and scrub the floor, or clean the toilet, or something like that. But you couldn't say, I'm going to go hang out in a bar, or buy me a drink, or something like that. You couldn't do that. But you could have in your own area on the other side of the track. And so were there a lot of black gay bars? Oh, I hope today there were a lot of them. Not as many as they got the white gay bars, but there were many. Because I was young and all these older children, I used to see them, you know, because all they would be in the bar, most of them used to drink wine and children. And during Prohibition, they had a place where they go and they used to make that wine. It was really, really cool. I don't know if they was making it, but it was really, really cool. It'd be ice cold and just one glass of a drinking kind of thing. It was really cool. And all the blacks would be in all them. And all the blacks would be up in the bars together, and the gays would have their drinks. But just like they got the white gay bars and the black gay bars, back then it was black gay bars. Then, of course, the only difference was the blacks stayed in their place and the whites stayed in their place. But what was going on in these bars? Were they music, or were they just kind of sit around the bars and just for dancing? Well, they had the piano. They put a nickel in the piano, they play a tune, and you could dance. That's before they had the music box. And you could dance if you wanted to. And we called it the funky but flimsy music. Because the ballroom at that time had songs all on the floor and everything else you see. And they may have
during Prohibition, they had what was called at that time a speakeasy. All you had to do was your side, where the speakeasy was, because it'd be just like a little club. They'd give you a little card or something like that, you belong to the club, and they would let you in with this. Just like in the election times, in those days, the boss was going to be your stuff. But what they do, they put a sheet or something like that over the liquor, and you couldn't see what was behind it. But they'd be open, they'd be selling that liquor underneath that hat. You know, sometimes I sit back and I think times were really hard for black folks at that time. But then too, we made it, you know, and then it wasn't like here now that people get shot every day, got one, two, three, long, you know. You didn't hear about all that shit. People get into a little horse or something like that. It was over. Today, if you just bump into somebody, they won't shoot you. What were some of the names that gave people a call back then? Was Sissy the main name, or were there other names that gave people a call? Well, we had Hazel, a little short hair baggy child. And that's because we had two Hazels. And to differentiate between the two, we had Black Hazel and Brown Hazel. Because one of them was round and short, and the other one was tall and dark skinned. So we say Black Hazel and Brown Hazel. We had Saul, and he used to live with his mother. He used to drink. And we have another one that's the one road. We had Magnolia Cole, and he used to hustle. And we had Her, and Her used to hustle. But had a house over on Eberville, the street where the project is today. The project is dead in the world. They had several other houses the Black Hazel did, but some of them just looked at the property. That was all before the district moves over there. And they had several of them out there. One of them was Sissy St. Lucie. There were a lot of them worked in the houses, like Dan Bradley and Mark Coleman. You know, they had two or three named Moses. And some of them worked on Canal Street. And some of them don't want to see them on foot. And they go to the market before they go to work. And before they go to work, they'd be in the bar getting a little drink. And then they'd get their stuff together before they go to work. Were the drag queens back then? Oh, yeah, child, I hope they did. We did have a couple of them, not a couple of them, more than a couple of them, because they used to hustle Tuesday dresses. By June 15th, these people died very long ago. In fact, all these people I mentioned, they died long ago. By June 15th, and several others, they used to put on dresses and dance and hustle at night. And they wouldn't have nothing in their room. But the bed, one chair, and that one chair be like right there, that door right there, and then that bed may be way over there somewhere, because the rooms were big. They were big. There wasn't no small room. The house had very large rooms. And you have somebody in that room right there, and we used to call them please. And they would get a trip, and they would creep in the door. And while the trip was busy doing his business, they go in his pockets to get his money. And that went on for God knows how long, because that's why they didn't have nothing in the room, right? Because if it get too big a hall, then they'd have to get out there, right? Because the people would go get the police. And then many times, the person that got robbed wouldn't even go get the police because they'd be ashamed to go tell the police. They would go up there with their black hookers. If they didn't know it was a sister, you know, he thought it was a woman. And even if it was a real woman, they didn't want people to know that they were in there, you know, with these blacks. Because you know, at that time, blacks and whites were close. Of course, they're not all that close now. But then too, they were far apart than we are today. So sometimes these were white men picking up black hookers. Well, no, not sometimes. Always white. No black men, honey. No black men. Even the black women that hustle, they would fool around with them black guys. Why? Because they didn't have any money?
That's right.
So what money is, don't fool around wasting your damn time with them blacks. Because a lot of them black guys were pimps. The women would hustle, they'd be giving them their money, they'd be dressing and looking like those princesses and all that stuff. Well, when did you first realize that you were gay? Oh, Lord, child. Must have been a baby child. Not a baby. I don't know what caused it. It just And then I kind of knew that I was quite different from the rest of the guys, you know, because all this been going for a woman. They be looking for a little girl, but still, I don't know. It just came on. I guess it's just like they say, it's born in you. I don't think anybody makes you do it. If it's not in you to be that way, you ain't gonna be. That's the way I look at it. So you remain pretty healthy, huh? Yeah, of course. In 83, I developed cancer of the colon. Then I had an operation. And then I had therapy, radiation therapy, for about 6 to 8 weeks. And I was told at that time, if I were to live for 5 years, I'd be doing all right. Well, I done lived. I done this since 83, so I guess I can keep it over. So you really enjoy life, huh? Yes, that's right, honey. I hope that they don't let them sit me in that chair holding my hands and twiddling my thumb, because that's not going to help at all. Instead of worry about this and worry about that, you know, I just don't let things worry me. I don't have too many eggs, you know, just sometimes I do a little stiff and things like that. But after I start walking or something like that, and move, then it's all gone. And the only medications I take is aspirin, and I keep my Alka-Seltzer. And to keep my beauty up, I use my oil for me. That's right, child, that's right. I can see it's working. Oh, it sure is, I hope today. Because I know people who's way, way, way younger than me, who look a lot worse than me. So I say I'm blessed. I got a couple of teeth if I want to put them in my mouth. But I don't want to hear it.
To be a home.
Y'all should stand up and stretch. It's hard to hear y'all get sleepy.
I got into theater by mistake. I actually enrolled in like PE or something. PE was full. I got in a class. The first day of class, she was like, okay, we're going to start to give introductions. And I stood up and I gave my name and I was being a smart ass. I'm in here by accident. Hopefully I can get my schedule changed. And I sat down at the end of it. And I went up to her after the class and I was like, what do I need to do to get a schedule change? But she's like, I don't think I'm going to let you out of the class. She's like, there's something about your voice that reminds me so much of Sidney Poitier, your presence. And I was like, here we go again. My people thank him back for so they're like, I had no idea who he was. No idea.
Stephen was born in Atlanta, Georgia in 1982, but grew up in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. My interview with Stephen stayed with me for days after. I was moved not only by the content of his life, but the passion and conviction with which he rendered it. I can see why he's been successful as an actor. He has a presence and a voice that I would imagine be very commanding on stage. The interview took place on November 2nd, 2004, on the campus of the University of Alabama. I had these feelings since I can remember, you know, it always been along the lines of I was just wired differently, you know, growing up, being around my sisters, I was really, really effeminate and would, you know, get beat up because of that, you know. And what I decided to do was that I would look at the other boys that were considered normal and I would tailor my behavior to that. And it got to the point where I really got good at it. It got to the point where it wasn't even an issue anymore because it got to the point where it stressed out my family so much growing up. And I vividly remember my mama saying, don't you grow up to be no faggot. I vividly remember her saying that, you know, because, you know, you're a faggot, you're a little girl, you're a sissy, and she was like, everybody is telling you this is wrong. So I was going to fix it. I'm not going to hang around my sisters as much anymore. I'm going to change, and I'm going to change who I am. And so I got to college, and I was known as the only straight guy in the theater department. You know, I really got good at it, But you tell what, the way you walk, the way you talk, that's the thing. Because I was raised around my sisters, and it was my mom and my sisters. I mean, women pretty much ran the house. So everything was done on that level. So my closest friends were my sisters, and we were always together. We acted like, you know, and I felt like I was being punished for being this way. Because at one point in my life, it was fine, you know, it wasn't a big deal. But I felt like I was getting punished for this. And then my sister got older, she was like, quit hanging around me and my friends. And so from every angle, I was being told, you got it wrong. So I fixed it. You know, I fixed what I thought people thought was wrong with me. What was wrong with me and what I thought was wrong. You know, it's so funny because, you know, I don't have girlfriends.
treated them awesome. Treated them awesome. It makes me wonder because, you know, I'm still looked at as being, you know, straight acting, masculine, you know, yet I'm out. And sometimes it makes me wonder how much of this is really me and how much is something I've changed to fit in. You know, when I got to college, nobody did. There was none, you know, there was a gay man that went in the closet. It was like, sister, who are you kidding? You know what I mean? It's like, come on, right? It's like, you're a gay man, it's not a big deal, but you're clearly a gay man, and that's fine. But there wasn't that pressure at all. You know, me coming out was so something that I had to do for myself because I was exhausted. I got to the point to where I got to college, and I pulled away from my family and my church completely. I stopped going to my church. Although I went to the University of Alabama, I only saw my family on Thanksgiving and Christmas. And it was right before I got to college, the pressure was so much, you know, it was so much all the time. And it got to the point to where, you know, I wanted to kill myself because of how deeply rooted I was in the church. I wanted to die rather than continue to displease the God that I love so much. Since I can't stop these feelings I've been told are wrong, I would prefer to die and be able to say that I'm going to heaven than to continue to live this way and go to hell because. And it got to the point to where, you know, I struggled and I hated myself for it. And when I got to college, I pulled away from all these things, pulled away from all these things that I've been taught and people around my life. And I really began to look for who I was. And it got to the point to where, you know, I made a realization that I believe in a God who's all-knowing. I believe in a God who doesn't make mistakes. I believe in a God that doesn't make mistakes. I believe in a God that has created me. I believe that I'm not a mistake. Who would choose this? It was just beyond me. It was frustrating so much being in the closet early on and hear people like, you know, it's a choice, it's a lifestyle change. It's like, you don't understand my struggle. I've tried that. I've read up on X-gay therapies. You know, I've tried to be what you thought Stephen should be, and I'm exhausted. And I was headed for destruction. I was either going to have to come to terms with this because it was something that I was ignoring for a long time, ignoring this fight within myself that was killing me. And it got to the point where I was like, no. No. From now on, what I believe is something that I find to be true for me and who Stephen is, and not something that I've been taught since I was small. So I started to examine my relationship with my family. Because, you know, it's so easy to be loved for something that you're not, than to be hated for something that you are. You know what I mean? It's so easy. You know, so I started to examine that. I started to examine my relationship with God, my Christian faith. Because when I got to college, I started to read about all these other people who weren't like me, who weren't black, who weren't Christian. And I started to read Mahatma Gandhi. And it was so odd because, you know, we held Martin Luther King as being the man. Well, Gandhi would have been Martin Luther King's man. You know, so I read about all these things that he did, how he took on the British Army, how he freed his people non-violently, and then he died. So I started to think, I believe that you can only go to heaven if you believe in Jesus Christ. And I started to sit with myself, and I was like, so what people are telling me is that Mahatma Gandhi is in hell? And I started to reevaluate. You're telling me that God hates me because of the way that he made me? Mahatma Gandhi is in hell? I mean, it was so liberating to be like, no. Because in terms of performance, the only way that you can truly be effective as a performer and effective in telling a story is for you to be comfortable with yourself. And because you have to assume somebody else while you're on the stage, and the only way that you can get some kind of understanding of another person is for you to have an understanding of yourself. So I started to move toward this point where I truly started to come into myself. Theater became, you know, it took on this world that, you know, I'm at a university where they don't put black people in roles. So I became the lead in the first all-black production at the University of Alabama. And so all these doors are opening, all these things, because I think it's completely related to me becoming more and more comfortable with who I am. And I know for the longest time I just fell in so many pits because I tried to be what other people. So funny, y'all. I guess the first time I honestly stopped to think about it was I was 17 years old, 16 or 17 at the time. I had a girlfriend. I really wasn't interested in the physical thing, I really wasn't, but this was something that both of our parents approved of. She was about 2 or 3 years old, 2 or 3 years. And the situation was where we were very close, but it was more like two friends, a boyfriend and girlfriend. And the sex thing was always an issue. It was always an issue. And so I thought, well, for me to prove myself as a man, we gotta have sex. The first time we had sex, I fathered my son. It was like, although he's something that motivates me, you know, someone when I get exhausted, when I really start to be like, what am I working towards? He motivates me past those moments. But it's one of the earliest moments where I was like, you got to this point being something that you're not. My son may be the only person in my family that I've come out to. Early on, the situation, relationship between our two families was really strained by the pregnancy. It was really strained. Well, here's the deal. Here's what's so crazy about it. When my girlfriend found out that we were actually pregnant, she called me, because we had broken up, she called me and she was like, well, I'm pregnant. I flipped out. This is yet again something that's confusing everything. Gay men don't have kids. So I go to my mom, and her first reaction is to really tear me down. You done threw your whole life away. You so stupid. I can't believe you did this. How do you know it's yours? How do you know it's yours? I was like, I know you don't know. They think we got money. That's what they think it is. They think that we're going to get some money out of us. So, we're going to get a test done. So, she calls her family. She says, we need to get a test done. And that really hurt her and angered her family. So they fought. And we were stuck in between this thing. And you know what was so odd about it is that it got to the point to where she refused to take the test. And my mom was like, well, there you have it. You know it's yours. We know it's not yours. 6 months later, she's married, moving to Texas. My mom was like, see, my freshman year in college, I get subpoenaed into court to prove paternity. My ex was under the mindset that if me and my family didn't want anything to happen, didn't want anything to do with my son, and he would be fine. So she went and married this guy who was in the Army, and they applied for insurance. Well, if you get insurance by the Army, all the information about the kids that have to be covered have to be on there. And for them to be covered, the paternity had to be certain. And it wasn't. So this was something that she didn't want to do. My mom told me to forget about it, you know, so my freshman year, I got subpoenaed because of it, and it got to the point to where we took the test, but it was something that she knew. It was something that I knew. When my son was, you know, I was in school, working two jobs, paying child support. When my son was in town, you know, he was with me and my family, my mom and my sisters, and I was so blessed because her family was so understanding, even after all of that. They were like, you do the best you can until you graduate. And this is right before I got my first professional job doing theater in college. And this is about 2 or 3 years ago. And I was having to leave for the summer. So the night before I was about to leave, I spent all day with the Darius. We were riding in the car. And I explained who I was. I was like, same way your mom loves her husband, I feel the same way about other men. I don't even know if you can understand this yet. He was like 4 at the time. I don't know if you can understand or not. If you do, let's talk about it. If you're not comfortable with it, that's fine too. More than likely, you're going to be angry because you don't completely understand. But come to me with that anger. Let's talk about it. That was it. It was surreal. It was like, here I am, coming out to my son. The only person in my family that I've ever truly come out to.
They're all amazing. I am a fantasy.
I'm very careful about this one. Because I don't buy the mythology that I feel more homophobic than anybody else. And the reason I don't buy it is because I grew up knowing gay people. My parents knew it, and I went to the church. And I'm not talking fully gay, I'm talking Frank and Queen, who ran the choirs. I met James Freeman as a child, and the Troubadours, who were an all-male group, and none of them were. And I met the Hawkins family. Yes, I will say, I met Edwin and Walter Hawkins, which really were out, some of them. I don't know how all of them, but I will say, those that are out now, I met them with
Doug is very much an activist in Atlanta, and everybody knows the interview took place on November 1st, 2004. What has been the impact of HIV/AIDS on the run? How much shape do you got? I don't want to be disrespectful to you and education and everything else, but that question is almost unfair. Because it's a whole other area. There are all these faces I don't have time to name. I'll just name one prophet who moved to Atlanta about the same time I did and helped me write an article that helped start my career as an activist. Helped me write an article that shook up the black gay community in such a way that they started attacking me actually, which was fine, but now it's fine. It wasn't then, but you know. It said something about us, about what we could do. You know, it shook things up. And then behind the scene, he was involved in Black and White Men Together, and he was a writer, and we were such good friends that we could stare at the phone, and I would go, Prophet's gonna call. And within 2 or 3 minutes, the phone would ring. Or I'd go, I need Prophet to call. And the phone would ring. We were connected, you know. And he ain't here. And that's the impact AIDS has had on my life. Because that would be a 20-something year friendship now, and multiply that by 100. And that's what AIDS has done to my life. So I don't know who I would be, because I would be different if Prophet were here. I would tend to get involved in black theater, not to be AIDS education, not to become a black gay activist. I was going to be a leader in the theater, honey. Y'all gonna pay to see me. And I was gonna take this to New York and fly around the world and have dinner with Diana Ross. Yeah, that's what I was going to do. And then we had to have this fucking there were conversations that I would never have had with my parents and been hurt, mortally wounded by my peers had we not had AIDS. And some of that hurt our own community around this whole business about being out and black and gay and lesbian and what have you. It's about people's fear of losing their loved ones. And they didn't have any language for it. They didn't have any way of dealing with it, you know. They didn't want to know. Because, you know, we'd already lost, you know, big mama to heart trouble or breast cancer or something like that that we also weren't talking about. And now we got this thing that's killing white fags and you want us to talk about it? No! And so, what would our community have been if we hadn't had AIDS? Can you imagine the Broadway shows we would have had if we hadn't had AIDS that I would have starred? And the fashion, I mean, we would be wearing different clothes. If Willie Smith were alive now, child, please. I know I would have lots of Willie wear, girl. At least I could afford it now. Yeah. Well, do you think it's become more of a problem here in the South, AIDS? I mean, the reality is that it is because of the numbers. But a problem is not a problem until you accept that it's a problem. So I guess it ain't a problem for most of them because they ain't accepted that it's a problem. Although it's a problem. How do you like that? I'd like to see that. How do you feel about the life choices that you made in light of being a black gay man? My next door neighbor, who shall remain nameless, is Mexican American. His father's first generation, I think, but I'm not sure. And his wife is a white lady from the South. And they have 2 beautiful children. And they've been very dear to me and Nate, but they just broke up. She moved to an apartment on Saturday and Sunday and took the children. And so I was comforted, a straight man who's coming to terms with what he's going to have to do to get his family back or get his life in order so that he can be happy with himself, his wife, and his children. And whatever I've done, I've never ended up in that predicament. And I came home to my love of 11 years tonight, and I've never been so fucking grateful in my life that I don't have that level of hurt and sense of needing to do something about my life to get it together. And
least at this particular point in time, I'm so happy with at least the current decisions that I've made. Staying with David, going back to be with David, living with David, marrying David, all in opposition to all the stuff that I've been taught and brought up to believe. And establishing a home with David, a home we welcome family into. I've had cousins here, I've had my stepmother here, and they love him. Yeah. I can't say I'm proud of every decision, but at least by some miracle, and I do mean it's a miracle, because we weren't always insane, and we were very popular and pretty and younger. I've made some decisions that have allowed me to be negative of HIV, but yet still involved in the epidemic, because my status has not prevented me from being infected and affected in other ways. Some folks might say it might be crazy. I might say that someday. And I think the big decision early on around going ahead, being black and gay, not something else, but being black and gay and going on from there was the big one that I'm most proud of. I'm not something to a so-called marriage to a woman. You don't go to other things to a woman. And my relationships with men were honest relationships. They didn't work, but they were honest. And I've loved men as fully as I possibly could. And I feel like I've been blessed to do that. I've loved women as a gay man, not as a straight man, but as a gay man. And I feel like I've been rewarded for that. You know, I've lived a full life, baby. If this tank were to get struck by lightning, and I were to accidentally get struck too, because it would be an accident, you know the memorial service is going to be enormous. Because I've accomplished a few things in this year. And you know, the program won't just read black and gay, you know, but if you need to print it there, kind of sissified, you know, or a little soft around the edges, or occasionally a vicious misthing, yeah. And sometimes in drag, and sometimes pretty in drag, and not just in drag, yeah. Wow, I hadn't thought about that. I'm glad you asked me that. And took my sense of faith, whatever that was, this week with me too, and questioned it. I don't need to be strangled by anything. So no, I have no regrets. For you see, I am black. I am gay. I am the South. Miss South.
Yes.
For any of the men that you interviewed, are they down or are they all down?
I didn't interview any men who described themselves as being on the down low, but I did interview several men who weren't what we would call out. I interviewed people who were out to certain people, but not to other people. Certain people were out to their families, who went out at work, so it was different levels of people. But I didn't interview anyone who self-identified as on the down
low. So, I came in about 10 minutes ago. Inspiration behind, you know, all of this, all of us that live this life today, and have you found what kind of satisfaction that has been found?
No, that question, I answer that question. One of the reasons that motivated me to write the book is about, I guess, 14 years ago, I was in Washington, D.C., at a cookout sponsored by this Black Gay organization called Us Helping Us. It's an HIV/AIDS outreach organization, and about 3 feet away from me at a table was a group of old men, Black gay men, at an average age of 65. And they were sitting around telling lies and talking about growing up in the South back in the day. And I was just kind of spellbound by that because being from the South, up in North Carolina, I had heard these stories. And so I said, you know, somebody needs to collect these stories. And so it took me a minute to get the resources and the time to do it, and that's why I went back. In 2004, I came back to the South and drove all around the South and collected these narratives. And at the time, I didn't know it was going to become a performance. About a year into doing the interviews, I had met so many wonderful storytellers and people who, when you read their story on the page, it's not quite the same as sort of hearing it. So I decided that it should be a performance in addition to a book. And I still didn't know whether or not I was going to do it or if I would stage it and have different people fight it for it. But because I'm an actor, I decided I would do it. That would be interesting for me to try to restage the interview, the original interview. But I never wanted it to be where the audience totally suspends disbelief. So that's why I play a clip from the original interview that you hear the person talking for themselves. And then and in terms of, has it been satisfying for me? Yeah. The book and the performance have taken on a life of their own. I didn't know that it would become what it's become. The book is, quite a hit. A lot of people are getting it because there's nothing like it, and they see a lot of themselves in the stories that these men tell. And the performance, I think, just adds another level to it, and it's becoming a stage play in the spring in Chicago or over in May.
What is the most shocking thing you found out in an
interview? Not just one. when I interviewed this guy in Baton Rouge, he's now passed away, during the interview, going back up. So he lives in this kind of, rough community where there was a gang. And the gang leader's house was about four houses down from his. He was sleeping with the gang leader to protect his house. So, So, during the interview, the gang leader came over, and in his own way was, how should I say this? He was interested in me. Which was a little confronting because I was there doing an interview with this other guy. So he was saying, the gang leader said to me, doing an interview. I said, yeah. this guy was sleeping with a gang leader, it was shocking because the gang leader was crying, you know, to have something jump off. And that particular person's narrative was really, everything he told me was shocking because he told me stories about the gang leader was married, his wife saw them having sex, called him and told him that she saw them having sex and said, if you don't believe me, look in your bathroom window, I have a coke can. And, but then the most devastating thing about the whole situation was he says that she knows that he's sleeping with me, but she's happy when he's sleeping with me because when he's here, he's not at home beating her. So I think that's probably the most shocking story I have. And that same man was harboring all this anger inside of him because his father was very abusive to his mother and had hit her in the head with an axe. And the next time his father attacked his mother, his siblings jumped on him and stabbed him with an ice pick. And he was harboring anger that he was too young to participate in beating up his father. So it's kind of some really serious psychological stuff there. So that was probably the most shocking thing I learned.
How do you feel about the portrayal of black gay men in the media, like such, like movies like Cover? Have you ever seen that?
Cover?
Yeah.
Oh, was that a strange video?
Yeah.
Yeah. I've heard about Cover, but I haven't seen it. You know, I think with anything, the images and representations, first of all, there weren't any, or very few, and all the ones that were, was, the Stack and Queen or something like that. And then we had, shows like Noah's Ark, and then we had the movie. So I think gradually we'll see more and more representation. I don't have a problem with representation of, effeminate gay men because they're a part of our community too. What I have a problem with is that they're the only representation, because they're not being like as many different representations as there are, gay men. But unfortunately, we just don't have a lot. I mean, I think it'll change as, people like me, Patrick Folk, who directed Noah's Ark and other, and what's the other black gay director? He did Dirty Laundry, Malcolm Jamal, I think. As people like that get more and more resources to do more films and television shows, I think we'll have more of a variety. Yes?
Did anyone ever interview you and hear Call of Jack or drop out of it?
Yes. Well, they came close. Someone I interviewed in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, who was a drag queen and a preacher. Yes. he's a drag queen at night, preacher during the day. He called about 6 months after the interview and wanted me to get out of the book. And I said, please, please don't. And then he said, okay, keep me in, but change my name and change all the things about my life. And then about another 4 months later, he called me and said, no, scratch that. I want my real name in there. I'm not going to be hiding anybody. So, but he was the only one who came close to dropping out. But there were some people who I had set up interviews with who then stood me up, so I didn't get there. But, yeah, he's the only one who came across.
Do you have something? What is your reception
I think that's very telling. Today, when I was on my way here, I just read a report about Morehouse, yet again, coming up with a dress code, because apparently there were some children cross-dressing. And now they're coming with a dress code that you have to wear certain clothes. And you can't, if you're a man, you can't have a dress or a skirt if you're a woman. Well, I'm not always women, because I guess they can't wear a tie. So, I haven't been invited to HBCU. I don't expect to be. But at other universities and campuses in the South, it's been a great reception. I was at Kennesaw State, I've been at UC Chapel Hill, going to Duke in a couple of weeks, going down to Tulane next week. And the reception has been great. Because I think people who would otherwise not want to see this won't come to the show. So I think it's sort of self-selecting in that way. In terms of the book, though, the book has been well received in the South as well. Very well received. I had the book launch in Atlanta last year at Black Gay Pride, and it was very, very well. So I'm happy. I would hope that at some point I would get invited to an HBCU, but I'm not going to. But you know, the girls are more happy. We're going to be on down the floor. Yes. Yes, tea in the gay community means gossip. It's a poor tea girl, still tea. But also sweet tea is a staple drink of the South. So that's why I named the book Sweet Tea, and the show is called Poor Tea. Okay. Sure. Yes?
I was going to ask, what have you personally learned through your work and this whole experience?
Too much to tell. It's been a humbling experience for me. I think one of the, and I talk about this a little bit in the introduction, you know, when I interviewed Chaz, when I went back home to interview Chaz, it was very confronting for me because I consider myself to be very open and out. But in that instance, being in my hometown and interviewing Chaz really challenged me to deal with my internalized homophobia and transphobia. So that was one thing I worked through. I also learned not to be judgmental about people who remain in the church, for instance. Because, you know, there were a lot of people who talk about the reason why they stay in the church, even if the, you know, the preacher is going on and so on and so forth. Because they talk about how the church was the first place where they were there. Creative sense was nurtured, and where they, you know, learned how to sing and so on and so forth. The church was very supportive, and when they came into their sexuality and started to have conflicts about their spirituality and sexuality, they felt that the church, even though it might be homophobic, was still a place where they found community. And so I had to learn not to be judgmental about that. So I learned a lot. And it was a very humbling experience. And I'm just so grateful that these men opened up to me and shared their lives in a way that's so profound and so important. And now we have this archive. And finding the Countess Vivian is just amazing. I mean, a 93-year-old can talk about, you know, the 20s and 30s, and then survived Hurricane Katrina, he didn't leave. And he'll be 98 in 2 weeks. And yeah, it's just, of all the narratives that I perform, his is my favorite. And I love that moment when I ask him what maybe we're calling, he doesn't understand the question. He's talking about Moses and doing good things and all these people. I just love him to death. And he is still feisty and still, you know, kicking. And he doesn't fly, but he travels by train, and he's planning a trip to Oakland by train. I love ending. Do you have another question?
Yeah, it's good. Do you think Black men here outside of the South would be that much different from the trans people from the same background?
To some extent, yes. some degree, yes, in some degree, no. I think there is sort of, you know, a general gay culture, and then there are, you know, shades of gay culture, like little black gay culture, Latino, Asian, and so on and so forth. But I think there's something specific about the South, the way we do. Like yesterday, when I was in Nashville, I was hanging out with a gay man who was from New York, who lives in Nashville now. And he was saying, you know, Andrew, one of the things that I just can't get used to in the South is, you know, when the children have parties here, they don't want you to bring anything. They want to do everything, you know. They want to cook and do all this stuff. And, you know, when me and my partner have a party, we like bring something over as a potluck. But these Southern children, they cook, you know, and they do all this stuff. And I'm like, yeah, that's what we do, you know. So I think that's unique to us, you know. There's something about Southern culture, Southern gentility, hospitality that makes us different. And also our relationship to space is different. You know, it's very different growing up, you know, in the South and being able to run around and climb trees and stuff than growing up, say, in New York where there, you know, it's, you grow up in, you know, public housing or, you know, there's not space to run around and do things. So your relationship to space and place is different. Yes.
Okay.
This is
my last question.
Like,
with your work, have you compared to, like, an Eamon Harris or something like that?
Or, oh, compared to Eamon Harris?
Yeah.
No, because Eamon's work is fiction, and mine is, you know, based on real people's lives. I did participate in a, y'all know Eamon Harris, I did participate in a tribute to Eamon Harris in New Orleans. A few weeks ago, however, his latest book just came out, and so September, I think September 25th, all around the country, there were these Eamon Harris tributes, because they were trying to make his book reach number one on the best, on a New York Times bestseller list. Because he's had a number two on the New York Times bestseller list, never number one, and I don't know if it made it or not. But Eamon Harris blurred my book on the cover, and says, and he, on his website, he listed Sweet Tea as one of his favorite books, so I really appreciate that. But I never got to tell him thank you before he passed away, which I really appreciate. One of the things I like to always close the performance with is telling a story about something that happened to me while I was collecting these narratives. And this happened in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. One of the women who helped me find him, her name was Anne McCarthy. She's the sister of one of my former professors. And Anne had arranged for me to interview this guy named Jerome, who lived right around the corner from her. And she was preparing Sunday dinner, though, if you know, in the South, that Sunday dinner doesn't mean at night, it's at a church. And depending on what denomination you are, it could be 1, 2, 3, 4 o'clock. So she was holding this till it's 4 o'clock. So she had prepared all this food, a big Kool-Aid, not cherry. And Jerome was supposed to come over for me to do the interview. So 4:15, 4:30, 4:45, 5 o'clock, Jerome comes to the interview. So she gives him a phone call to find out what happened to him. And Jerome gives us some song and dance about why he can't come. I'll come back to that story in a minute. So she's really, really upset that I come all the way from Chicago and did the interview. She gets out the phone for her. Kate starts going through the phone book, calling up men who she thinks is gay for me to come over, for them to come over, and for me to interview. And so, like a good Southerner, when she called them, they would never, she would never cut to the chase about what she was calling for. She would, you know, start asking about, how's your mama? Out of church today, and all this chit-chat. So then she finally get around to, well, you know, Trudia's former student is here, and he's writing a book on Black gay men in the South, and I thought that you would click. So all these people started hanging up on her. So she called this one man, which is called Ron, and she was going down to watch Chicago. One of Tree's former students is here, and he is writing a book on Black gay men in the South. I thought you should come over here and make an interview. There was this boom over the phone. He said, "I'm not gay. Why are you calling me? I ain't gay." And she interrupted him. She said, "Rob, you know you're gay. Your wife know you're gay. Your children know you're gay. You need to come over here and interview. I'll let this boy interview for your book." But she did find somebody to do an interview who did come over. But going back to Jerome, who was supposed to come over for the interview, he called me about 2 months later and he said, "Brother Patrick, is Jerome with us loose in our family?" Well, they talked to that thing then. He said, "Brother Patrick, when you were here, I didn't do that interview because the Lord had spoke to my heart. And he hadn't told me to do that interview. But when I heard your voice, Brother Patrick, the Lord said, Help that child. So you come on back down here, Brother Patrick, and I'll give you that interview." So I did come back down. I did do the interview. And during the interview, he tried to save me twice. So I'll let y'all read the book to find out if it worked.